is Republican Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina. He sits on the Senate Finance Committee. Senator, I want to get to taxes in a minute, but first I do want to get your reaction to President Trump tweeting this morning and yesterday about his decision to fire his national security advisor, Michael Flynn. He tweeted, quote, "I never asked Comey to stop investigating Flynn, just more fake news covering another Comey lie." Obviously, the former FBI director, James Comey, testified before the Senate Intelligence Committee in public that the president asked him to end his investigation into Flynn. Do you have any reason to believe that Comey was lying under oath?
I don't know all the facts, so I'm not going to pretend to know those facts. I can say that Senator Warner and Senator Burr are doing a really good job of digging into all the facts in the intel room, and that's really important for the American people. With that bipartisan group working together, we'll know all the facts by the end. We do know this, though. Mike Flynn broke the law. The FBI continues the investigation, and I think we'll find out the truth before, hopefully by the end of this year or early next year.
Your fellow senator from South Carolina, Lindsey Graham, told CNN that he would urge President Trump to pledge to not pardon Michael Flynn. Do you agree with that?
I do. At the end of the day, here's what we know. We have to have a way to restore confidence of the American people in their elected officials and the leaders of this country. One way that you do that is by holding those folks who are, A, lying to the FBI, you hold those folks accountable, and B, you have a process that is clear and transparent. When the intel committee is finished, we'll have the facts.
Let's turn to the tax bill that the Senate just passed. You were a big part of that. Tennessee Senator Bob Corker, your fellow Republican, was the only Republican to vote no on the bill. In his statement, he said, quote, "At the end of the day, I am not able to cast aside my fiscal concerns and vote for legislation that I believe, based on the information I currently have, could deepen the debt burden on future generations," unquote. As you know, the Joint Committee on Taxation looked at the bill before it was changed on the Senate floor. They said that even if you factor in the growth projections, this legislation would still add $1 trillion to the national debt over the next decade. As more boomers retire and tap into social benefits like Social Security and Medicare, how is this bill not burdening younger generations with the cost of this tax bill?
Well, if you look at the last 8 years and look at the actual cost of government continuing to explode, one thing that you conclude after the last 8 years is our debt went from $10 trillion to $20 trillion. Our economy stalled. If we continue to spend more than we make, and we should find a way not to do that as a government, and our debt continues to explode, we do burden the next generation with more and more debt. One of the fastest ways to fix that is economic growth. We are in a global competition. We must win that competition, which means that our tax code must be competitive with the rest of the world. When that happens, American companies will churn out more profits, more revenues to the government, and we will be able to deal with our national debt.
But the Joint Committee on Taxation said that even with growth, this bill is going to add $1 trillion to the national debt.
Yeah, there's no doubt that the JCT has been consistently underestimating the activity in our economy because their model is based on a closed economy. That basically means that all the activity that can happen from the markets and capital production happens within the country. The truth of the matter is that we are in a global competition. When you bring home $2 trillion worth of overseas profits back to the country, able to create more than 1 million jobs, when you're at full employment, wages rise, more economic activity happens within your economy, we are in far better shape to see the numbers that we're talking about eclipsed. We're not thinking about a $1.4 trillion economic activity. I believe we'll get a lot more. In other words, Jake, what they're saying is we're going to have to slow the growth of the economy by about 50% over what it was growing. Today we're growing at 3.1, 3.2%. Before the Trump administration took over, we're around 1.9%. We'd have to cut that growth rate significantly, and we'd still produce $1.4, $1.6 trillion of economic activity over the next 10 years. So they're saying we're going to slow the economy by cutting taxes. That's just inconsistent with reality.
Well, Senator, one of the big criticisms about this bill is the process, making sweeping changes to the bill at the last minute, some of them handwritten in the margins of the bill. Voting on it, even though some Democrats voted on an effort just to have a couple days to read the bill. Listen to your colleague, Senator Elizabeth Warren from Massachusetts.
They have just released the tax bill. It is about 500 pages, and they want us to vote on this thing in about an hour. An hour. I spent more than an hour making a decision about the refrigerator that we recently bought. They're sending around their edits as we speak. Edits.
Another Democratic senator, John Tester, said that there was one page of handwritten text, I think it's the same that Warren was showing there, that he couldn't even read. Were you able to read the entire bill before you voted on it?
I went through the entire bill. I'm not going to say I read every single letter on every single page, because 470 pages in this last hour, I did not read 470 pages. But have I read every aspect of that bill before it was fused together? The answer is yes. We have had the chance over the last 3 years since I've been on the committee to work on every aspect of the bill. The question that they're actually addressing is not whether or not you've read the bill, it's whether you've read the bill in its current form. But if you take every component piece of the bill, yes, we've had 3 years of meetings, hearings, and committee hearings around those issues. And the difference between the hearings that we've had during the committee and then the committee working its way through subgroups over the last 3 years is very important. So we had five subgroups working on every aspect of that bill that came together in the last hour. But that last hour was not the accumulation of new information. It was a culmination of 3 years of meetings, hearings, and hard work by committee members that may not agree on every aspect of the bill, but we certainly knew what was in that bill far before, long before the last pages were printed.
Well, you're saying that you knew what most of it was, but not necessarily the additions that were added to the bill in the last hour or two. I'm old enough to remember the 86 tax cut bill. It took 15 months. I'm just wondering, I mean, just as a simple yes or no, I mean, was this the process that you had hoped for, to have all these changes made at the last minute?
Well, Jake, I'll say it this way. The last hearing that we had was a 23-hour hearing. We had 63 Democrat amendments that were offered. The suggestion that this was not done in the light of day, and the last-minute changes as they talk about them were last-minute changes that had been envisioned for weeks. We knew at the end that there would be dials that were changed. So here's an example. We increased helping small businesses by about 2.4%. That happened in the last hour or so, but that had been envisioned for the last 10 days because we had been talking about that. So we had another amendment by Senator Rubio to increase the child tax credit. Had that happened on the floor, that would have been a last-minute change, but that was something else that had been envisioned. So there were no new ideas, no new opportunities, simply opportunities that had been envisioned that were going to be voted yes or no on the floor and then fused into the final product. The suggestion that we had so little time to take a look at 500 pages is inconsistent with truth.
All right, Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina, thank you so much for your time, sir. Appreciate it.
Absolutely.